My name is Karen Hill, and today is the 24th of April, 1984. I'm in Vancouver today. This is the Oral History of Social Work in Canada project made in association of social work. Today I'm interviewing Miss Katherine Whitman, who has had long experience in social work across the country. Miss Whitman, in order to begin, I wonder if you might tell us when and where you were born and a little bit about your early background.
I was born in Nova Scotia, in Annapolis Royal, to be precise, in March 1900. And, however, I only remained there for a few months. I was taken to Sydney, Nova Scotia, and from back from there to Bridgetown in Nova Scotia, and a little later, spending most of the winters in Halifax, and most of the summers keeping as near my father as we could. He was a civil engineer, and he was working on railroads in Nova Scotia at that time. And we camped or boarded at farmhouses nearby where the work was going on. Mm-hmm. My mother and I was an only child then.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And did you go to school in Nova Scotia?
Well, when I was of school age, the winters had to be spent in Halifax, and I had cousins there, one cousin just my own age, and the two of us started at a little private kindergarten, and we went there for a year, and then from there to Halifax Ladies College. And I was there every winter until I was 9 years old, and then my father got a job, still railroading, up in Ontario, and we moved to Upper Canada.
Mm-hmm.
And spent one winter there in Sudbury, and I didn't go to school that winter. My mother didn't. My mother thought the public school was rather rough. There was no other school to go to. So a little high school girl came in every afternoon and tutored me. Brought me up in spelling and arithmetic, in mm-hmm. which I was quite poor.
mm-hmm.
But then the following year we moved to the Sioux St. Marie, Ontario. And I went to public school and high school there until 1916. And then moved down to Toronto. I don't know whether there's more to say about that period.
When you went to Toronto, did you go directly to university there?
No, I hadn't finished high school. And went in the middle of the year in fourth form and managed to scrape through my junior matric. And then grade 13 the following. And after that, we moved to Ottawa.
Oh.
Those were war years, and my father was working at the Shade, a little place outside Ottawa, on the firm there. I've forgotten how it was. And so we camped near there that one summer and then moved into Ottawa. And I was through high school, didn't know quite really what I wanted to do particularly. My mother was terribly interested in missionary work, and I sometimes thought that I should go in for that, but I didn't feel too well fitted for it. And I rather liked drawing and so forth, and took some courses in drafting at the Ottawa Technical School mm-hmm. that winter, but that was a dead end. There were no... the war was over by this time. This was 1919, and the war was over. It was another period of unemployment. Men were coming back from overseas to their jobs. And girls just didn't do drafting anyway. So that was that.
Mm-hmm.
And then I don't know how it came about, but I read some books by Jane Addams on the settlement work.
Was it?
For Chicago, wasn't it?
That's what she was.
Yes. And Hull House. I couldn't remember for just where it was. And I found it was very interesting, and I thought, there, that's what I'd like to do, settlement. And after some writing round and inquiring and so forth, found there was this course in Toronto in social work. Social service it was in those days. And enrolled for that. So I went down to Toronto, back to Toronto then. That was the winter of the fall of 1920. And took their 1 year course. There were no residences. Well, some of the individual colleges certainly had residences for women, but there was nothing connected with the Department of Social Service. So, but the YWCA had their Dominion offices in a big old house on Jarvis Street, and they had a number of rooms in the attic. Five or six rooms on the third floor, and they turned those into a little residence, and 10 of us were able to board there. We used to go on boarding. We had kitchen facilities where we could get our own breakfast if we wanted to. We worked on the system,
mm-hmm.
and it was very nice.
What were some of the courses that you had that time?
Well, we had ethics, social, economics, English. The head of the department was Professor Dale. His subject was English. I enjoyed those classes very much. Recreation. I'm not at all musical, and I had no musical education, but and we were supposed to copy out certain songs and so forth, like the youth, children, and so on, and in group work. And I copied them very faithfully because I was afraid. I didn't know what the squiggles meant, so they had to be perfect.
Mm-hmm.
And, however, about, partway through the course, I was persuaded to change to casework, that is group work, which had been my object in going there. Yeah, Miss Agnes McGregor.
What persuaded you to change from casework to
group work? Well, it was the other way around.
Oh,
I entered to, I wanted to do group work. Well, it was Miss Agnes McGregor, I think. She was really a student advisor and so forth. And she was quite right. I wouldn't have been at all good in group work. So, so my field work was done with the Department of Public Welfare in what would be their family work department. I'm getting dry again. I haven't heard these parts. And I never regretted that. Then I did get my certificate that the following May, and in the fall started work with the Neighbourhood Workers Association in Toronto. In one of the downtown districts. And
what district were you in?
Moss Park.
Oh. Were you working with Barbara Finlay still here?
And Barbara was later. Mm-hmm. She did. She was in settlement work at St. Christopher House.
Mm-hmm.
And I did know her at that time.
Mm-hmm. So you began the Neighborhood Workers. What, 1921 was it?
That would be the fall of 1921, yes, September.
What kind of work were you doing?
Well, I was what they called a field worker, and the district offices were small. There were most of them had less than two workers. So there was the executive director and a field worker. And I was the field worker. Miss Jean Walker was the district secretary. And I don't know what training she'd had, but she was very good with students, and she put me through my paces.
Mm-hmm.
I got as much from her, I think, as I did from the chorus.
Mm-hmm.
But so I was there for, I don't know whether it was a 4 year or not. You know, that was a time of very serious depression. Everybody thinks of the early 30s as being the depression years. But after the first war, things were very bad. And Toronto welfare wasn't equipped to deal with the numbers of unemployed at that time. Of course, there was no unemployment insurance. And there was relief in kind. The people were handed out a bundle of groceries, and once a week from a central depot. Nothing, there was no means of paying rent. And then the Young Men's Board of Trade raised a lump sum of money that was to go toward rent loans. And the intention was good, but it was rather futile altogether. They were given for just 1 month's rent, and they were supposed to be repaid. And most of the men just had no more chances. They were going to be put on the street, and it prevented that for 1 month,
mm-hmm.
in the hope that they'd get work.
Mm-hmm.
But most of them remained in debt. What they did in the future, nobody knew. But anyway, those interviews were being handled by the Department of Public Welfare, or whatever the name of it was at that time, and I was loaned to the department to take interviews. So I was there for some months, and then I think I was transferred to the Parkdale district of the Neighbourhood Workers. It suited me very nicely because my family were in Toronto at that time and settled in Parkdale. So, and I was with, I was a field worker there too until I think it was the beginning of 1927, and I was made district secretary in University District. That was a small district there, and I had one assistant.
What kind of work were you doing as a field worker? What kind of thing?
Well, it was a little bit complicated the way the neighborhood workers were functioning at that time. One reason it was called Neighborhood Workers Association and divided into areas like this was it was to be a coordinating agency. And we received applications from people wanting assistance of some kind. And then found out what links in the neighborhood they might already have, like church connection or what other agencies they'd been in touch with and so forth. And contacted those people and to see if they would take over the case and deal with it. And where there were no such facilities, then we kept the family ourselves to work with. And then, of course, there were other problems that automatically would go to other agencies. And there was no social service index at that time. You had no means of contacting anybody to find out who the family had been in contact with. So it was a useful function, I think, but it's a little bit unsatisfactory in some ways. It didn't give you enough time, really, to work with families that you wanted to.
How much of your work was helping with financial needs?
Not really a great deal. We had a very small emergency allowance, and which was no good for continued relief at all. I'd forgotten. That was $40, $50 a month, something like that. Well, you could, that was more than it sounds these days, but even then, it was only emergency service. It would do for a weekend order of groceries, for instance, which you kept for $33. But even things like that didn't go too far. And when it came to paying rent, just wasn't much use at all, except to pick somebody up off the street and put them in one housekeeping room for a week, maybe, until something further could be done.
What would you be trying to accomplish with the families if you were working with?
Well, to try to form a better family group where often sometimes parents were separated, sometimes they were together, but where there was a complication of irregular work or illness, breadwinner ill, and just family troubles generally, and we weren't too well equipped to cope with them, especially the very young social workers, but we did manage to accomplish something, I think, with children, too. We did try to extend the work to the children.
I'm thinking of your assiduous note-taking of the music.
I'm afraid that was a bad loss. I do remember paying for our little girl's music lessons at the settlement house that time. I think most of it had to come out of my own pocket. I don't think our agency allowance ran to that. But it was quite a help to her. I don't think she ever became a musician, but it was something she needed at that time in her life. So.
How did you work for the settlement houses?
Well, they were part of the neighborhood too, you see, if you were fortunate enough to have one in university. It was the university settlement in Toronto, and Parkdale. Well, I suppose St. Christopher House was on the edge of it. It was the one, I think it was St. Christopher's House where this little girl went for her music lessons. It was close enough for her to walk to. Mm-hmm. But they were certainly represented on our, part of the coordinating was to bring the different workers in the neighborhood together, and we had monthly meetings for that purpose, monthly luncheon meetings at various places, and settlement workers and churches, and all the others in the neighborhood were asked to come to that. They were all invited to come anyway.
And those were organized by the Neighborhood Workers Association?
Yes.
What would happen if this?
Sometimes there was a speaker, but just the, to discuss the problems of the neighborhood, and what resources might be developed and so forth.
Would it be similar to case conferencing where individual families would be discussed?
No, it was just coordinating and developing the resources.
At that time in Toronto, did organizations like the Social Service Council and the Charitable Organization Society, did those things exist, to your recollection?
Not under that name. I don't know when the Welfare Council, Toronto Welfare Council started. Oh, there was the child welfare meet, child welfare council, mm-hmm. I think. Now, when that began, I don't know, but it was pretty soon.
And was that the Toronto organization, or was that the one that became the Canadian Council on Child Welfare?
I think it was purely local, in the beginning, anyway.
Did you have a relationship with the Children's Aid Society in the Bay?
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. Occasionally, got cases had to be referred on to them. No, it would just be a case of referring.
Mm-hmm. During that period of time, as I understand, Charlotte Whitman and the Canadian Council on Child Welfare were quite active across the country in different kinds of surveys and advocating for social welfare. Did you have anything to do with Charlotte or the Conference of Council on Child Welfare?
Not too directly, and of course, for Charlotte Whitman that did make a survey here in the Children's Aid Society in Vancouver, and was instrumental in having that was 1925-26, I think, because in 1927 enough reorganization had taken place. Enough work had been done, I think, perhaps is the way to put it, with the board of the Children's Aid Society, that Miss Holland and Miss Collins were engaged to come out here and take over the work. And then Miss Holland engaged me to add to their numbers. Mm-hmm. And I joined them in September 1927.
How did it happen to you,
Ms. Collins? I didn't really. She was with the Department of Public Health of the City of Toronto at that time, and I knew of her, knew who she was, and but hadn't had any direct contact as far as I remember. I do remember Zella because she was with the Big Sisters Association. And so I knew her. And I don't know who recommended me to Miss Holland. She was having a hard time to get somebody, I know that. And she phoned me at work one day and put the proposition to me. And it was a big move. I wasn't too sure. So I said, well, give me a couple of hours. I'll call you back this afternoon. So I phoned home thinking, well, I'll try it out on my mother, see how she receives this. She wasn't home, she was out of the meeting. And I phoned Mr. Stapleford, who was head of the Neighbourhood Workers, because I couldn't give him too much notice. And he had been appointed district secretary not too many months before. I wasn't quite sure that I should even consider this matter. Well, I couldn't get hold of him either, so I phoned Laura back and said, I'll come. And I didn't regret it, really.
That was a big move to come from Toronto to Vancouver in 1927.
Yes. I had one friend out here, somebody who had taken the course at the university with me.
Who's
that? Helen White. And she was working with the YWCA out here. So I thought, well, it'd be nice to see Helen again anyway. It won't be quite a stranger in a strange land. And so it, I came, this was in August, and I came out in September.
Mm-hmm.
And landed at the YWCA, got a room there. They found me a room, sleeping room, visitor, And I was ready to start work the next day, I think.
What was your job?
Well, the plan was that children were to be placed in foster homes. They were all in a big institution out on Wall Street. And there were close on 200 children in the big building, I think. And there's another smaller building that had the babies again. And I think the large building had already been condemned as not safe from a fire standpoint. And the idea was to get them placed in foster homes as soon as possible. But there were a lot of other things to do too, was the trouble. And first thing I had to do was learn to drive a car, because it was pretty hopeless getting around Vancouver then with public transportation. Now, they had good public transportation if you want to go north and south. Mm-hmm. You could get downtown very easily, but everything went downtown. If you were in one part of the city, if you were out here at Point Grey, for instance, you'd have to go downtown and then out to get out to South Vancouver. There were no cross lines at all. Mm-hmm. The streets were there, but not the trams didn't run. They weren't buses, they were electric streetcars. Mm-hmm. And you get out to New Westminster easier than you could get some places fairly nearby. So it really required a car. And the Children's Aid covered not just the city of Vancouver, which was smaller than it is now, because it did not include, I don't think it included Point Grey actually, I think this was a separate municipality. Southern Vancouver, I know, was separate. Marple was separate. And Burnaby, of course, which still is. And turned out an awful lot of my work was in Burnaby.
Did the agency supply the car or did you check for it?
No, there was an agency car. It wasn't in too good order, but it had been run rather hard, not mm-hmm. given very good care, but it was there. And it didn't have to go through tests at that time. Anyway, you went in and bought asked for a driving license into the city hall, I guess it was, asked for a driving license and paid your dollar and were handed the form. So that was that. You were free to drive it if you could, but I couldn't. So I had to have a few lessons from the old garage man, and then was ready to start off. Some of the places were rather difficult. I remember having good deal of trouble getting over the Second Narrows Bridge, which was a toll bridge at that time. And I don't know why, but they seemed to put toll offices up a little slope, the head of a little slope. With an old gear car, I wasn't too skilled in driving. I stalled every time. However, it soon came. But the first thing to do, really, was not to look for foster homes, not right away, but to look up lost wards. There were, I don't know how many children legally under care of the Children's Aid Society. Well, you know, 500-600 anyway, maybe, and quite a few more than that. And a good many had been placed in private homes and were still under 16 years of age, which was the legal age. And the society was legally responsible for those children. They had not been legally adopted. They'd been placed on a form of indenture, which was meant really to be used for children placed in working homes, where they'd be earning their board for their services. And they was to protect them anyway, give them certain rights in that situation. But it had been used for very young children too, and in some cases, at least, the parents had not been, the foster parents thought they were adopting the child, and they was theirs legally from then on. So they moved without letting the society know and that sort of thing. And there was no supervision once they were placed.
Can I ask a question about
this? Yes.
So at that time, 1927, there were homes that were working homes where kids were placed to help out the family and get paid. But then there were adopted homes, which where there was no necessary connection between work and the placement.
They were bringing the child up as their own child.
And in both of those types of homes, you were finding children of all ages?
Mm-hmm.
I see. Or you were trying to find the children?
We were trying to find them, because a lot of them had moved. Now, some kept in touch with the society, partly because they wanted the assistance of the society if they were having any problems. But others, as I say, the child was theirs, they were bringing it up as their own. And in many cases, they were getting very good care. But there were problems with some others. I know one family in particular were having a great deal of trouble with a child who was quite low grade mentally. And they weren't getting any help at all with her. And I don't know why they hadn't appealed to the society before, but they hadn't. And they were very glad to. I think they were, in the end, relieved of her care altogether. It wasn't my particular case. I'm not sure just what did happen. But our first duty, anyway, was to get around and visit these children at the addresses we had for them and find out if we could, if they'd moved, where they were, and so forth. And that meant right down the valley, too. They weren't just around here.
Mm-hmm.
So all the little towns around had their quota.
Mm-hmm. What about the situation in which the children were in working homes? What kinds of settings would you find the children in?
Those would differ according to the children, of course. Some were placed in working homes where they would get paid a little. They had to be through school. Some were placed as young as 13, 14. They were receiving their care, the room board, for services after school, before or after school. And that was done very generally, I think. And there too, some of those children were getting along very nicely and were being treated really very much as a member of the family and getting on all right. But others were not at all happy in the situation and were being taken advantage of, and in some cases had to be removed.
The idea of a working home is something in my limited conception. I would think of a rural place, a farm, as a place where youngsters can work.
For the boys particularly, yes.
But Vancouver is so urban. Were you finding kids in urban working homes?
Right down the valley. Overdale, Alder Grove, all the towns down there, Langley Prairie.
Mm-hmm.
There are children placed there.
What kind of work would the kids be doing if they were placed here in Vancouver and working homes?
Mostly they would be girls and looking after the children.
Mm-hmm.
And as I say, it might be it might be a real working home where they were getting wages, or it might be that they were still attending school and doing part-time service.
One of the issues that I understand was current in some places across the country at that time was the issue of immigrant children who were in
Bernardo
some cases,
home.
The Bernarder homes, and in some cases, the immigrant children were being brought in strictly, evidently, to do domestic service or farm work.
Mm-hmm.
And there is some hint that Children's Aid Societies were involved in encouraging them.
I don't remember any. I do remember it being a problem with the graduates of the Bernardo home in Toronto. Great many of them came to the attention of the social agencies later on when they married and had families of their own. Weren't too efficient at looking after them. But and a lot of those were very unhappy placements. After all, they were picked up in the cities of the old country and knew nothing of farm conditions and sent out here. There were some bad results. And there, too, there was nobody to keep track of them, you see.
Mm-hmm.
No agency here was supervising them. But I don't remember that occurring in BC. I guess it was too far away.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Many of the children that came to the society, though, came from throughout the province. They weren't all Vancouver children that we received.
And did that make a difference in the kind of foster placement that you were trying to find
for them? To some extent, though I don't know. Some of the ones from the interior were very nice children. It wasn't very difficult to find homes for them.
Another thing that was happening in some parts of the country was the profit maternity homes. Is that something you were affected by?
No, I don't think so. They were. Places of that kind were lacking, I think. There was an infant's hospital here in the west, down the west end, and quite a lot of children would get left on their hands. The police would pick up an abandoned baby somewhere, that sort of thing, and take it into the hospital, well, that needed medical care, or maybe they had admitted the child from the parents, and when they came to discharge him, there was no place to send him. Couldn't go keep the parents. And there were cases like that, and I know that we took some of the children from there when they came 2 years old. We couldn't keep them beyond that. And they needed placement very badly because it was a good hospital, but hospital care for a well child isn't the ideal situation. The nurses didn't have time to do their proper jobs, let alone look after well children. And children would spend most of the time in their cots. They weren't learning to talk. They weren't even learning to walk. They hadn't had proper exercise and so forth. And we did get children from there, and then gradually, while they came to the society, if they were abandoned, the society was notified immediately and could take them instead of having them stay there for a couple of years. And we found to some extent, the same situation existing in the children's aid shelters. There was a beautiful building for the preschool children. And I've forgotten, I don't think they did have children under a year anyway, but they were quite young anyway there, and a lot of them that should have been talking hardly knew a word, could hardly say a word. They hadn't been talked to, they hadn't been played with. It was a nice building, but there was no equipment. And lack of staff. It wasn't only just that they weren't trained staff, they just had too much to do.
So that was the situation that you found when you came at your mm-hmm. primary assignment.
So that
was to try and get foster homes.
Try to get foster homes to fill in there.
When when you were ready to begin getting foster homes, how did you go about it?
There had been a lot of publicity, and so we did get people inquiring, and I'm not quite sure whether they wanted to make formal application or not, but inquiring about the conditions and interested. I think perhaps we got a good proportion of people that really wanted to be helpful. We got a lot that weren't really too interested in the money proposition, because that was the point. Children had always been placed for the children's aid, but nothing had been paid for. So we were asking for boarding homes, not adoption homes, and that was quite a new concept. And but I've heard. Other people in other areas feeling that that was a real problem, to be sure people weren't just doing it for the money. And I don't remember that being too big a problem here. Now there'd be some. Some you could weed out, of course, just in the first office interview. You didn't have to go any further. But we got a good many nice people who wanted to be helpful, who liked children, and quite a number that want a company for their own only child, that sort of thing. However, it had to be rather slow going, and I was reading an old report of the Children's Aid Society, and if I hadn't read it there, I would find it difficult to believe. This was the fall of 27, and they say by the end of 28, that's just a little over a year, that I think it's 168 children live in place, something like that. And there was only one person to do it, and to do other things, to do other things in between. And I can't quite believe it went as fast as that.
He must have been working many, many hours.
Well, I'm afraid records suffered. It didn't get really very professional records on the foster homes. However,
what kind of program or support would new foster parents get from the agency at that time?
Well, that was another thing. The children couldn't just be placed; they had to be visited regularly, and it had to be fairly time-consuming, too, because it was no good just popping in and out. You had to sit down and discuss it with the foster parents as to how they were getting along, and so forth and so on. They got support in medical care. We had doctors, volunteers, for the various groups of children, and they held clinics at the agency. And the children from foster homes were brought in for regular examinations, as well as for any illness that occurred. We got our scares there, too, sometimes. there's an epidemic at one point. I think that's too strong a word to use, but there were enough cases to be scary. Of what was termed black measles. It turned out to be smallpox. And we had a foster home right next door, with children, right next door to a family that developed smallpox. Fortunately, our children had been vaccinated, but some of the neighborhood children hadn't. And I think one in the foster home hadn't been. Their own child, I think, had not been. However, that too was all right. It worked out all right, yeah.
During the period of time you were with the Children's Aid Society in Vancouver, I'm wondering if you have a recollection about the issues, what benefits for you and for the other workers?
Well, because the biggest problem was just getting around, even hitting the high spots. But I think just the usual problems that any children's agency, anybody responsible for children, have, with usual problems did arise. We tried to be very careful in facing children, but it is difficult to tell whether a certain child is going to do well in a certain home. I think that's the biggest problem always in facing children. I know I always worried about the legal adoption cases. That seems so final. And you never want to have to rectify a mistake that's been made in facing children in a foster home. Still, it's not as bad as if the child is legally adopted. Now, I don't think it was legally required that there should be a probation period in facing a child for adoption, but if I remember correctly, that was one of the things that Ms. Holland did institute was a waiting period before the final papers went through. And whether that was a legal requirement or whether it was just an agency rule, I do not know. That was difficult. Then another crisis, and this was about 1931, I think, was when a great many Dukapore adults were put in jail, and we were required to place the children. There being no other place to send them. Some of the parents were brought down here. I think a good many were jailed at Agassiz, where they still are. I don't mean the same ones. And about some did come down, were sent here, the women particularly. And where there were small children to look after, we had to find homes for them. And it all had to be done in quite a hurry. And I think most of them worked out fairly satisfactorily. The children were not problems. They were healthy, normal children. There was the language problem. They didn't, the wee ones didn't speak English. The older ones mostly did. But it was having the children go to school that caused some of the problems in the province. So even some of the bigger ones haven't had too much schooling. There too. By that time, we did have a little more staff. So I think I was doing just just looking for foster homes at that time. But at first, you see, there was nobody else to supervise afterwards. The home had to be found, a child placed, and then I had to do the supervision. But the first person to be engaged as extra staff was a trained nurse to supervise the infants and to pass on the homes for the infants too. So that to be sure that they were all right, because by that time we were taking wee ones 2 and 3 weeks old as soon as they left the hospital. Mm-hmm. And by 1931, we did have a fair number of field workers. And I can't remember just when and who was the first.
You mentioned earlier some names, though. Who were among you?
This nurse, who was a Miss Campbell, she was not a social worker. Then one of the quite early ones was Elizabeth Hall, Dr. Elizabeth Hall, who was a The doctor's a PhD, not a medical doctor. And she came. She was here quite early. Margaret Keith came from Toronto. And she still lives here. She's Mrs. McIntyre. She was with the society in the early days. And think of them because they were in a rooming house next to mine. We didn't consider it necessary to have apartments in those days. I don't think any of us really wanted apartments. It was so too much to look after. You could get a bed sitting room. And the landlady looked after that. And you really didn't have any home responsibilities, particularly. Gladys Smith was one of the early ones too. She's Mrs. Lloyd Fulford, Montreal now. And she was very good at supervising the older boys, some of the older boys and girls. Well, she was very young herself at the time. Lucy Ross, who was a local person, was one of the early staff. Oh, Lois Kingston from Ottawa. And she was here for a couple of years. Most of these people did wander back again at some point.
Some of the names back and forth. I wonder if, just as a final question of this section, if you could remember what it was like to work for Miss Holland and Miss Collins.
Oh, well, they were wonderful people to work for. We were sort of in it together. And anybody did. I don't know how Miss Holland managed it. Miss Collins was laid up with bronchitis that first winter. It was a very bad winter anyway. Rain continually. The doctor told us we'd have to give it up altogether unless she kept right indoors, which confined her to office work. And she went over all these old dusty records, opening them up. They were long legal forms and folded over into, well, the way lawyers' forms are, I think. And you couldn't pull out a folder and open it. You had to pick out one of these things tied with tape and undo it. Mice had been in them. Dusty and dirty, some have been there for years. And this was only 1927, but after all, the society had been operating since before 1900. Mm-hmm. And some of them had been there all that time. And all these had to be examined to find out which children were still underage and needing attention. So she did that, and how Miss Holland did the investigations which were required, I don't know, really, because she had to do so much work with the board and speaking at meetings. There's no good trying to do things without the public with you. And she had all that to do. And, as I say, investigating any complaints that came in from the community. Mm-hmm. However, she managed it, and by spring, Miss Collins was able to do that part of the work, too. And writing, quite a lot had to be done by letters, you see, so she did anything of that kind that could be followed up from the office. Even telephoning, which isn't too pleasant when you've got bronchitis. She did get over it anyway, which was good.
Maybe it would be good to stay right.
Yes.
Miss Whitman, when we left off, we were discussing the work of the Vancouver Children's Aid Society. You left Vancouver in 1930. 1932. I'm wondering why you left and where you went.
Well, I left for two reasons. My family was situated in Toronto, and I felt it was time I returned there. And I really wasn't as interested in my work at the end of the term. I was doing foster home finding entirely. Others were able to take on the supervision of the children, and it was really the work with the children that I found more interesting. It was, I found it a bit unsatisfactory just to find the home and give a description, as good a description of it as I could, and from then on somebody else was dealing with it and placing the child there. And I did like the continuity, although it was difficult to keep up with the with it all. And of course, as the work grew, one person couldn't possibly do it. It had to be divided like that. But it was chiefly for family reasons that I left.
Mm-hmm.
And then, once I had discussed it with Miss Holland that I was leaving, I'm not quite sure how the creche in Toronto got my name, but I had a letter from them asking if I'd be interested in going there as the executive director of the day nursery, which was situated in downtown Toronto. And I was very tired at that time. I didn't want a job of any kind. So I said I couldn't take it on before the fall, but that I would be interested in it. And so it ended in my starting work there in mid-October 1932. And it was a nice, the nursery was in a nice old house down on Victoria Street, just across from what is now Ryerson Institute. It was in the normal school. And a few of our children did go there to school, whose mothers could pay $2 a month for the fee. And it was quite a change from neglected children to children whose mothers did want them, and trying to make a living for them. A good many were from broken homes, of course, and the father out of the picture. On the other hand, there was a family group in quite a number of cases too, where either his earnings were not sufficient to keep the family going, or was unemployed, or had some physical disability maybe, something of that kind. And it wasn't too big a house, but it had been one with double parlors, I think they were probably called that time. On each side of the central hall, there were two big rooms with folding doors in between them. And good windows, high ceilings, 12 feet. And had children from a few months old up to about 12 years old, attending the public school from the nursery, and in fact attending whichever. Either the separate school or the public school, whichever they belonged to. And we were open from 7 in the morning till 6 at night, 5.5 days a week, closed at 1 o'clock on Saturday. The children were brought in any time between 7 and 9 and spent the day. The ordinary ones had the downstairs rooms because they didn't disturb the little ones as much there. Smaller ones were upstairs under a nursery school teacher. At least she'd had training as an infant in one of the infant schools in England, which wasn't exactly the nursery school. Not quite along the same lines as nursery schools these days, but she was very good with small children. And always before, there had been a matron in charge, and who took the applications, didn't do any home visiting, didn't really, just went on her judgment from the first interview as to whether the child needed care or not. Didn't have much contact with the other agencies at all, and hadn't had any training except in running an institution, if that. Before I arrived, one of the board members who was very interested in nutrition had arranged that instead of a matron, a housekeeper would be engaged with some knowledge of dietetics, maybe not a qualified dietitian, but who'd had training along that line. And that was working out very nicely. She supervised the cook and house staff. And I took over the other responsibilities. It did not mean living in, which the matron had always done. And we had, had staff, some of whom had had some training with preschool children, others just got the training on the job. She was quite a good practical nurse with the baby group. But one thing that attracted me about the job was that it was felt that the wee children under two should not be in an institution, that if they needed care, they should be in private homes. So that took us back to the foster daycare as against the full-time foster care, needing the same sort of attention. A little more complicated, really, with children going to their own homes every night. However, we felt it could be worked out. The unfortunate thing was that we were in another depression this time. This was 1932, the end of 32, going into 33. And there was no money. I'd been warned before I took the job and stated the salary I wanted that there'd probably be a 10% cut because all the agencies were accepting that. And there was. So there was no money for this foster daycare. After all, that would have been an extra thing in the budget. The institution costs would be exactly the same because the room occupied by the babies would be used for somewhat older children, and there wouldn't be any saving, but the foster daycare could be an added service. So it was out of the question at that time, and there was already a mother's club consisting of women whose children were using the nursery or who had used it. Some of the children had graduated, but the mothers were still interested in coming together and had their own little group there. And they were enjoying it. And there were others that round about living in rooming houses that would enjoy it too. So another group was formed, the mothers that didn't necessarily have that nursery connection. And we took a separate little group of neighborhood children in on Saturday mornings when our numbers weren't too high, and they came in just really a play school group, what they called now.
And then we started Saturday night parties. And the school rooms downstairs were used for square dancing. I've forgotten who raised the money, but a pianist and a leader were secured anyway. And the ones that didn't want to square dance played euchre in the boardroom. And they liked those parties. They were gay, not much in the way of refreshments, but they always had something like donuts and coffee and that sort of thing. And anyway, they were well attended, and we kept those on until things were better and they could afford their own recreational outlets, at least to a better extent than they'd been able to during that time. Because it was a period when even the mothers using the nursery were finding it difficult to obtain work. And a great many of them just did daily housework, but there too, employers couldn't afford to have them anymore. Or, if they did, they reduced their pay, and other expenses weren't reduced to that same extent, and they were all finding it very difficult to manage. I don't know just where to go from here.
How many children were you dealing with at the time when you first began?
Around 70.
Mm-hmm. And how did that change over the years? You were there from 1932 to 1966.
Yes, well, we weren't in that same building. We were there until 1952. And it was then that fire regulations were tightened up. And the old building could have been renovated to that extent, but it would have spoiled it rather. The whole staircase would have had to be closed in with a door at the bottom. The small ones were meant to be on the ground floor, not upstairs, which would make it difficult with school children coming in and in and out. And it would have lost its sort of atmosphere altogether. There seemed to be a need at this time, too, for children who had problems, like autistic children, mild schizophrenia, various things of that kind. And a question came up as to whether they could be dealt with in a group of comparatively normal children. The West End Grace had were experimenting with having a separate group of children that needed practically individual care. And our board were interested in seeing if they could be absorbed into regular groups. Anyway, they wanted to carry on much the same program, not with the clubs and so forth that we'd had. It was a little girls group too. We had teenage youngsters. But the work with the children under better conditions than we had. And they finally found an old house on Jarvis Street. And closed down the old place. There was one frantic year. We were entirely closed down. The new building wasn't to be ready for a year. All arrangements were made for the care of the children we had, either to other nurseries or something or other. And then the city decided they'd give us a grant to keep us open for another year. Half the staff had made other arrangements too. I didn't know whether I was glad or sorry. our nursery school teacher, head nursery school teacher, who really was the head children's worker at that time, was ready to stay on. And a few of the staff of the children. And I think we got our old cook back. The cook's a very important person. We did get our housekeeper back, but she had another job. But and this was only a year, you see. So anybody who'd obtained another job, it would have been foolish to give it up and just to carry on for another year. However, we got things going, and we did carry on there for another year with the fire regulations waived for that period of time. And then in 1952, the new building on Jarvis, just north of Wellesley, was opened, and the incorporated as the Victoria Day Nursery. The old one was the creche at 374 Victoria Street. So they carried on the Victoria. I don't know quite why. But
And how did things change when the creche became Victoria Day Nursery?
Well, we had much better qualified workers. And if we were going to take children with special needs, we needed a psychiatric social worker. That wasn't easy to find. So we did open up, with me still just as executive director. And I couldn't stay in that position and also have a psychiatric social worker. It just wasn't enough money for two comparable salaries. So she, whoever we got, was going to have to come in as executive director. But dealing with these special cases too. So I was really their sure assistant. We did get Viola Gilfiller in to start in the fall. And she's still in Toronto. But she's retired too.
And so you continued on and invested your time at Victoria Day Nursery. Yes. What was your position?
Well, I really was assistant there and looking after the financial end of things too, budgets and so forth, and doing some work with the children, some interviewing with the families too that wanted care. Mm-hmm. It's sort of a mixed up job.
Sounds like a little bit of everything.
Yes. Well, I've had experience with that, you see.
Yes. Yes. Over the 34 years that you were with the daycare center, what were the most significant changes that you saw?
Well, the biggest change, I think, was just about the same time that we started, about the same time that we made the move to the new building. We began to get a different type of mothers. Still quite a number of young ones, but better educated people, qualified for better jobs. And, but much the same old problems, but I think perhaps a little better able to cope with them if they had some assistance in doing so. And then, well, we did have some different children too when the Hungarian children families came. Why, we took a group of them while their parents were learning English. And they were in a special group because they didn't know English. They were, they'd have been lost, I think, in the other groups. And they were only with us for a limited length of time. So they were, we had another work around the style, another children's work around the style. That's another point. We did have a qualified nursery school teacher as director, and a good many of her staff did have training. Otherwise, before that, they'd been trained on the job, and it made quite a difference in the groups and the way they were handled. And a little Hungarians got along very nicely. went back. I think some of them came on here to BC eventually. Somewhere in there, yes. I think I said 54, but it wasn't as soon as that. 56, I think, is the time that a good many came. A whole university staff, I think, came out. And these were children of professors, some of them were, and teaching staff, and I guess some senior students, too. But we had very little contact with the parents. The parents were taking crash courses. They dropped their children in and ran and collect them in a hurry at night, and there was the language barrier, and I don't think we were expected to or tried to do anything too much about that. Had to wait. I must have been a member before I came out here, and I don't know quite what year it did start. I have the membership list for 1928, and I know I paid a fee for that year, but how many years it had been before that, I do not know. And I really am very hazy about early meetings. Mm-hmm. I know that, because these days I wouldn't have been qualified to be a member, but I was one of the original members of the CASW. Mm-hmm. What's the word I'm groping for?
Charter member,
yes. So that was when I was with the neighborhood. Back when I was with the neighborhood workers. Mm-hmm.
And over the years, did you continue your membership?
Yes, up until not too many years before I retired, mm-hmm. And I dropped it then because I really wasn't going to meetings very much. Mm-hmm.
I'm wondering if, in that connection, you have some thoughts about what it's meant to you to be a social worker.
Well, I've always wished I had better qualifications, more education. I do think it's important, and because I felt myself handicapped, even if, as quite a number did have at that time, they had their university, an arts course or some general course to start on, which meant they were eligible to take special courses along social work lines. But to stop and go right back to the beginning was too much. I never had an opportunity to do that. But it was nice to be accepted on the qualifications I had, and I tried to learn as much as I could as time went on. Mm-hmm. One of the first things I did after I got to the nursery was I felt I knew very little about preschool children in a group. So I did take some lectures then, Dr. Blotz and his workers, mm-hmm. St. George's Nursery School.
Mm-hmm. Another question that I'd like to ask is, as you look back over social work accomplishments, are there things which you're particularly, or about which you're particularly pleased with you've done over the years?
Well, I think we did accomplish a fair amount at the nursery by establishing a certain setting. It seemed to me the children did really show improvement with the care they got there. And we had a good relationship with the parents and could see quite a number of them improving too. We did get quite a number of young parents very ignorant about bringing up a child, but open to suggestion, and were able to improve their handling of a child with a little help. And parents and mothers alone that had more or less given up the struggle and weren't doing a very good job of their children, and they really just needed a bit of backing. I feel I like the day nursery setting, and daycare now, I don't know whether they do have as close a relationship with the parents as they might have. I think perhaps they do. I don't know how many places do have a social worker involved, or whether it's the teacher altogether. I think both are needed. But you do, in that setting, get in on the situation before it gets too bad. Not always before the home is broken, but sometimes even there. Do something to prevent a breakup.
So in the daycare setting, the combination of teacher and social worker.
Yes.
Family,
I think so, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm wondering if there are things that you'd like to add, questions that I haven't asked, or things that you'd like to talk about.
Well, I think perhaps we've covered the field pretty well.
Okay. Well, in conclusion, well, thank you very much for spending time with us this afternoon.
Well, I'm pleased that it can be any help for the field as a whole.
Much appreciated. Thank you.
This is the social service building of the department of that department of the University of Toronto. That's all, isn't it?
When was it taken?
Taken in 1920.
If you remember where it was.
It was situated on the southern crescent of Queen's Park. Six oh four Jarvis Street was in 1920 the Dominion building of the YWCA, and they housed 10 students taking the social service course.
That's where you lived.
Yes, I was one of the upper 10. That's all you want from there, isn't it?
Do you
want
to describe the lady? Is it Miss
Ford? Yes. Now, wait a minute. Marjorie. We were more formal in those days. Didn't use first names. Miss Marjorie Ford was head of the Y at that time.
Did she act as sort of housemaid for you?
Just just gave general supervision. See, we didn't wreck the place or anything. Say who they are?
Because they were your classmates.
Yeah. Sorry. This is Dorothy and Ruth Chisholm. Ruth was the only one not going in for social work. She was at the Conservatory of Music. The next one are four of the students who lived at the Y. Myself, I can't see who that was. Yes. Sorry, I can't get that. Ruth Chisholm, Miss, May Curtis, and Dorothy Chisholm. This is a corner of one of the rooms that we occupied. This one is myself, Helen White, and May Curtis.
And this one says the House of Industry. Is that
that's where this trio lived in that big room, and we called ourselves the House of Industry because we worked so hard. This is a certificate received after 1 year's work at the Department of Social Service, U of T, in May 1921.
Now, what are these other things that are here?
Oh, those aren't anything there. No, that was just the letters I received for taking the job.
Well, what's that? Can we get that one? That would be good.
This one was photographed, and that's the. This was saying about their plans for placing the children in foster homes.
Hold that one there. See if we can. Is that straight enough that you can get the words?
Yep.
Oh, that's good.
I don't know what date this was. It's 1932, early in 1932, I think, but I've forgotten what month. Can you see the month on there? April 21st?
April 21st, 1932. Yeah,
I didn't bring my reading glasses because I didn't think I'd need them.
I've got mine.
No, I don't think so. This was about the children's aid here, and that's history. Children's aid history.
Mm-hmm.
That was the door in the building at 1675 West 10th, I think it was. Oh, that was just a little memo I came across on my own.
That's not history.
No, and these are just CASW things that I thought you might be interested in seeing. That's the first one.
I don't think there's anything else there.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Again, thank you very much. Now, a couple other little pieces of business.